The outcome of a coin flip is completely random. Only it's not random at all. If I'd known exactly how the coin started and what forces acted on it, and if I could do the calculations quick enough, I could have predicted the outcome. It only looked random because there were these hidden variables I didn't take into account. We'll call this classical randomness because this is the only type of randomness allowed in classical physics. Things only look random because we don't know all the factors influencing them. The situation in quantum mechanics, though, is quite different. Remember, we met the wave function last time and we said it contains each of the possible things the particle could be doing. As we know, when someone or something looks, it has to be doing just one of those things, though. For example, in the double slit experiment, if we put detectors behind each door, we'd see each particle go through just one slit. But which one? Standard quantum mechanics says that this is truly random. Unlike in classical physics, there is no extra information you could get or extra calculations you could do that could let you predict which it will be. It's not that the particle really was doing one thing all along. If you hadn't measured it, it would still be in a superposition. But when you do look, it has to choose only one option, and because that choice is truly random, there is no cause for it. There is no reason why this particle is measured at door one and not door two. But that doesn't mean that every option is equally likely. Consider this example. We do the double slit experiment again, but this time we put one of the doors a bit farther away. We still don't know which door the particle went through, so it must still be in a superposition of going through both. But if we measure it, it should be more likely to go through the closer door, right? This fact is reflected in the wave function through those coefficients that I've been ignoring. In this example, they could be these numbers. You interpret this as the bigger the number, the more likely the corresponding state is to happen. In this example, the probability that the particle is measured at the closer door is 3/4, and the farther door is 1/4. The exact mathematical rule for this is very simple, but it's a bit of a tangent at the moment, so I'll put that in a short video by itself. Quantum mechanics does have an element of true unpredictability, but that doesn't mean that the theory is useless. You can't predict where one particular particle is going to go from its wave function, but if there are a bunch of particles with that wave function, quantum mechanics lets you predict their overall behavior very accurately. There's one other aspect of the measurement rule, that measurement causes the wave function to collapse. Say something measures a particle and finds it in a particular state. What does the wave function look like now? Remember, the rule is that the wave function is in a superposition of all possible states, but now only this state is possible, and so the wave function collapses to just this. This actually has a dramatic effect. In the double slit experiment, if I measure which slit each particle goes through, that collapses their wave function so that now each particle really is just going through one door. That means they're not interfering with themselves, and so we get the regular pattern. The particles land in two bunches. So here's an interesting scenario. Say Bob is measuring which door each particle goes through. Bob sees this particle go through slit one, so he says the wave function collapses to this. But what if Bob didn't tell Alice his result? Is the wave function collapsed for her or not? Is there an experiment she could do to tell? Feel free to pause the video if you want to think about it. The answer is, if one person or thing does the measurement, it doesn't matter if no one else knows the result. The wave function is collapsed. This is a bit surprising because imagine if Alice goes and measures which slit the particle goes through straight after Bob. Her result looks completely random to her, just as if the particle was in a superposition. But this isn't true randomness anymore. She'll get the same result as Bob, but since she doesn't know his result, it looks random just because she's missing that information. Instead, what she should do is look at the pattern on the screen. As we said just before, because the wave function is collapsed, she'll see the particles land in two bunches. This explains one of the big questions about quantum mechanics. Why don't we see quantum weirdness all the time? Why don't I see an interference pattern when I throw apples and don't watch which door they go through? Because even if I'm not watching, plenty of other things are. The apple will interact with light and air and make sounds, etc., and they collapse the wave function for me. So quantum superpositions are rare because they're so fragile. We talk about quantum effects with very small particles in very controlled environments because those particles really aren't interacting with much, and so they can stay in a superposition. And now you guys know the two parts of the measurement rule. First, the outcome is random, but the probabilities come from the coefficients in the wave function. And second, after a measurement, the wave function collapses. And so, it's question time. First, what if there are three slits and you only have a detector at one? What does the wave function of a particle that goes through look like before and after? The second question is about what counts as a measurement. I kind of implied that interactions with air and light count. Do you think all interactions are measurements? What about if a machine does a measurement and then, without storing it in memory, prints the result and burns it? Is the wave function still collapsed? And finally, one about interpretations. What do you think of quantum randomness? Do you understand why some physicists had a problem with it? As you may know, there are hidden variable alternatives to quantum mechanics that don't have true randomness. Does this make them more appealing? Is there anything you don't like about hidden variable theories? Finally, thank you all so much for your answers to the slightly more philosophical questions last time, and sorry I fell behind answering. I'm really looking forward to your answers this time.